Creamer Media's Mining Weekly is interviewing Tony Hodge, the president of the International Council on Mining and Metals, the ICMM, a mining industry organization with the world's biggest mining and metals companies as its members. The aim of the organization is to be a catalyst for strong environmental and social performance in the sector for the benefit of host countries. Tony, can you tell us about your latest report now that can give mining companies a guide as to what to do?
I'll tell you this: what this report did. We wanted to understand how mining would factor in the decision-making mindset of national decision-makers across the world. So we have tried to assess the role of mining in the national economies of each jurisdiction, all 214 national jurisdictions across the world. It hasn't been done before, so we're very proud of it.
That's fantastic. And what, why and how? Why is it essential to contribute to economic and social development? Why is it essential that mining contributes to this?
Well, two things. First of all, I'm going to take one step backwards, and that is that mining industry, of course, is criticized by people all across the world for not giving enough. They're a taker, not a giver. The reality that we found is that the role of mining in national economies is already very, very significant all across, in many, many countries across the world. And we look at which countries. Oftentimes, it is the emerging nations where it's most, most significant. Now, is it enough? Obviously, I think we can do a lot more, and our organization is in the business of doing a lot more. But the companies themselves are already contributing a great deal, and that's part of the message here.
Do you know, mining has a finite horizon. We know that we'll deplete those metals and minerals. So to say mining is sustainable is a bit of a misnomer. But how can mining add to the sustainability of the economies of the host countries which it's operates?
Well, you've put your finger on a key thing. Mines come and go. There is no doubt about it. They are not going to go on forever. And we shouldn't be talking about a mine that goes on forever. That's not possible. But the contribution of mining goes on and on and on. And what we want to do is make sure that that contribution is as much as possible. One of the things that we've learned, we have all these arguments about taxes and royalties. In fact, the greatest contribution of a mining operation up front is the attraction of foreign direct investment so that you get the infrastructure in your country that you need. Your water systems, your power systems, your communication systems, your road systems, the sewage systems, all of the things that we need to build our societies over the long term. Our education systems, that all starts with that. And that's where the contribution starts. Secondly, mining operations lead to the generation of export earnings. That's what allows our countries to participate in the international market so that they can purchase the goods and services that they can't get at home and bring it here for the benefit of people. We forget about that part of it, and the contribution concept includes all of that. Now, we also have to look at the real costs and risks. The costs and risks borne by the company, which are significant, they have their investors, and that's fair. But there are also costs and risks borne by the host communities and countries. They also have to be considered. That together allows us to understand what the true long-term contribution is. And our little report right now is a step looking at the macroeconomic part of this, because it is complex and we've got a ways to go to understand the big picture. You were talking before this interview about the need to look at the big picture, and I profoundly believe in that. We can't just take little tiny decisions, knee-jerking on today's activities, when it's the long-term and the big picture that we have to understand to make good decisions.
Now, your organization has a strong South African membership. About
very
a
strong.
Third of the 21 yeah. members are listed on the Johannesburg yeah. Stock Exchange. In South Africa, we have a problem with, you know, unemployment, inequality, poverty. How, in your view, could more be done in South Africa, which is a mature mining country, to actually help towards closing those gaps of unemployment, poverty, and inequality?
Do you know one of the very, very interesting things that's very much on the global radar right now is the evolution of the Sustainable Development Goals that will be confirmed by the United Nations next September, October, whenever. And at the heart of that, the first priority of that is poverty alleviation. And if you look at the role of mining in supporting society, the role of mining in alleviating poverty on the long term is going to be profound. Are we doing enough today? I don't know about that. I think we can do more. And to do more, it's going to require a very careful collaborative conversation between miners, between involving government, involving communities and the others in societies to build a win-win-win formula to making this happen. There is no textbook recipe. We're on new ground here.
Okay, so there is no textbook recipe, but there possibly is a sort of a theoretical to-do list. What is on that list? That what must mining companies do to attempt, anyway, to make a positive contribution in host countries?
Do you know, I tell you a wonderful story. A colleague on the council, on our council, one of the chief executive officers of one of the largest companies in the world, was telling me about how he was going to visit a site that was going through a major refurb. He got picked up at the airport. He had an hour and a half drive out to the site with the mine manager. He's a technical guy, an engineer with many years of experience. The entire hour and a half was taken by talking about the relationship between the mine operation and the community. This is very different than 10 years ago. So what do mining companies have to do? At the key of that, at the very center of that, is building relationships with the people, the workers, their families, the communities around them, so that they are making decisions that work not only to protect the interests and the investments of the shareholders, which they must do by law, in which is very important. You and I are the shareholders through our pensions and so forth. But they also now must consider the needs and aspirations of the host communities and the host countries in which they're operating. And that's a change. That's a different skill set. No longer is it just how do you get the right angle on the pit wall. This is about human relationships, different skill set. They must do that differently. And the good companies are doing that differently, which is very interesting to me.
And is there a not to-do list? Are there certain things that mining is just not acceptable, could make a negative contribution?
The key in what I'm saying, in terms of the do, this is a surprise. I'm an engineer by training, and this is my world that we were talking about. We have to learn to listen to this social context within which we're operating. These are from an engineering point of view, these are the boundary conditions, but they're not technical boundary conditions, they're social boundary conditions. So what must engineering people in mining companies, what must they not do? They must not ignore the social boundary conditions. They have to learn to listen physically and hear and absorb and factor that into their decision making. And again, the good companies are really making great strides on this front. In Daba last week, Cape Town, we had people, mining technical investors and so forth, in one side of the room. We had people from the alternative mining in Daba over there. We are beginning to talk together, and that's a great step forward for South Africa.
And you know, this whole issue of labor intensity versus capital intensity, you know, what should mines do? Should they remain labor intensive, or should they be at the cutting edge of the latest technology?
It is inevitable. It's utterly inevitable that over time, in search of efficiencies, there will be technological solutions which will change the labor picture. It has to be. With what we have seen over the last 5 years, big increase in price that came ahead of the increasing cost curve catches up to increasing prices, then price cost curve drops, cost curve carries on, price curves are a perfect storm. That's exactly where we're sitting right now. And part of the cost curve, which is very significant, are labor costs. And as people get more educated, as people evolve, as societies evolve, I'm sure that the cost of labor will continue to increase. And mines will have to seek more efficient ways and safer ways of dealing with the conditions underground and in open cast mines. So that's inevitable. So it is absolutely inevitable that the technology will come. It is coming. There's no doubt about that. What has to happen, and again, the good companies are doing this, you cannot treat your people like junk. You have to do this in a way that ultimately allows a transition which takes care of the people. And after all, that's what the union movement was originally built on. And there's a role for that. And we need to learn about that and talk about that. And we're at the beginning of that process. There is no doubt about that.
And you're a global organization. You've got a global membership. You've got so many host countries. What is your overall message? What is the message that you would like to leave to in a global sense?
There is a message, and it's a very, very important message. And that is that there are many people across the world that feel that the way that the mining industry operates is unfair. It takes, it doesn't give. The global message is that needs turning around. And the smart mining companies, the good mining companies are learning that to give is the source of the stability that is in fact going to protect their very investments that they're charged with protecting. So mining companies must be a development, call this an engine for development. Engine for development in a way that will be driven by the values of the people in the host countries, not from afar. And that's a big change from 50 years ago, a big, big change. The key at the heart of that in terms of the message is that that can be done, it is being done, and we're moving along that path.
That was Creamer Media's Mining Weekly talking to Tony Hodge, the president of the International Council on Mining and Metals, the ICMM, speaking to us about the way in which mining can be a powerful engine for economic growth.